podcast catered to all you geeks out there. I am Neo Synapse from the Superpowered Review, and I'm here with Super Patriot from the Daddy's House.
What's up, everybody? How y'all doing?
As usual, you can check out his Twitter and mine. His Twitter is at the Daddy's House, and mine is at TSP Review. His YouTube channel, just search for the Daddy's House or Super Patriot. And for me, you can search for the Superpowered Review. All right, let's get right into this thing. We've got some news to cover. First up, the Inhumans movie date has been moved? No, it has been removed.
Removed, yeah. It was kind of surprising getting that news. They haven't really gone into any detail, as far as I know, as to why they removed the release date. Mm-hmm. It was originally slated for July of 2019, I believe it was.
July 12th, 2019.
Yeah, July 12th, 2019. Kevin Feige did state, though, previously, I guess, saying that, you know, it would more than likely be delayed or the date would change on it. It's odd, especially with everything that's going on right now with the TV side with their Marvel Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. because the Inhumans are taking which we'll discuss later. The Inhumans are definitely taking the forefront on the TV series. So. I'm kind of curious as to what the reasons for the removal of the release date. I mean, are they moving it up? Are they pushing it back? What's going on here? Did they change the date because of something else that was announced for that weekend? Because sometimes, if something's going to be going up against something else big, the studios will move release dates around or try to find a new release date. So it will do better that weekend.
Right. And it was moved once before for Indiana Jones when that was announced. They said they had to move it from that November 2nd, 2018 release date. And given the critical reception so far to Spider-Man, specifically in Captain America Civil War, a lot of good things have been coming out of that about Tom Holland's performance as Spider-Man, it could be that they're thinking of getting movies about Spider-Man around that time, so they had to move the date back or, get rid of it completely. Who knows?
That's a good possibility as well.
Right.
Also in the news, this week, we've got, you got something there.
Yeah. We've got Tilda Swinton. She is the Ancient One in the Doctor Strange movie that's coming out. And there's been a lot of fan backlash because traditionally the Ancient One is portrayed by an older Asian gentleman. So there's been a lot of fan backlash. And that's been going around for a lot now with the whitewashing in Hollywood. A lot of people are complaining about roles going to, either different genders or different races, that kind of thing happening. And this is just the latest alongside, what's her name there, Black Widow. Scarlett Johansson's role as the Major in Ghost in the Shell, who is also traditionally an Asian character, and these two people are white, so people have been kind of going crazy about that.
Yeah, I don't really get it because stories are, everything's up for interpretation, mm-hmm. in my opinion, and. I'm sorry. I haven't watched a lot of anime, but the anime I have watched, none of the characters in those animes look Asian.
Right.
I'm sorry. Goku does not look Asian to me. none of the characters from Robotech looked Asian to me. And I don't really see an issue with this. Now, the gender swapping of the Ancient One. It's kind of a new take. Mm-hmm. It's definitely a new take on that for me. But, I don't really see, was there a lot of uproar over Idris Elba portraying Heimdall in the Thor movies?
A little bit.
Really?
Yeah. People were complaining that because it was based in Viking culture and those people are like all white in their opinion, as far as the gods, the pantheon of gods that they have. When he was portrayed as black, people were like, oh, no, this can't be, blah, 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 blah. you know how that goes.
Mm.
It's pretty interesting.
Well, and here I thought we were living in a day and age where everybody could just look past the color of someone's skin.
Yeah. you would hope.
The thing is, too, it's the same people complaining about this stuff that are the ones that say stuff like that.
Right.
You know, we should be able to look past the color of someone's skin. Right. You know, a black man should be able to portray a Viking in a movie. You know, and the same thing over the whole fiasco with him taking over the role of James Bond. I remember that,
yes.
Too.
Oh,
People went through the roof on that. James Bond's not a black man. Mm-hmm. You know, I think he'd be really good at the role.
Yep.
You know, but it would definitely be a, significant, character change,
mm-hmm.
For him. But I don't think James Bond is, more of an ideal. As far as I'm concerned, Sean Connery's the only real James Bond anyways. But nobody's been able to do it right since Sean Connery.
I've heard a lot of that. I really have. I mean, my favorite, as far as personality and charisma, is also Sean Connery. But right. I prefer the current crop of movies because they speak more to my sensibilities about action and things like that.
Nobody does it better.
Right. I agree. He was super cool. If nothing else, he was incredibly cool.
It was definitely smooth, man. It was just, my name is Pussy Galore. Well, of course it is.
Yeah.
Oh, it's one of my favorite lines, man. It's one of my favorite lines from one of those, from their movies, man. But yeah, I don't get the whole whitewashing thing. I mean, I understand where people are coming from, but at the same time, they've even the owners or the publishers of the original Ghost in the Shell anime, they came out and said that, Scarlett Johansson's, this is an American film. Mm-hmm. It's an American interpretation of the story. Mm-hmm. They have no problem with it.
But you have to take that with a grain of salt because they did get a massive check. In order to use their property.
Yeah, but I'm pretty sure there was no stipulations in there where they said, okay, we're going to pay you for the license, but we're going to cast a white woman.
Right, definitely. Absolutely.
Only on the condition that you're okay with us casting a white woman, and you come out later in the press and say so.
Right. And then there was that whole issue about the studio trying to use technology to make characters look more Asian.
Yeah, that's kind of sly. If you ask me, I'm like, really, really, you guys did that? I mean, what'd you do? Did you narrow their eyes more? I mean, come on, man. I mean, geez, oh Pete, people.
Right.
Next up, though, something we'll also get into again. Speaking of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. from before. Do we have news here that Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is going to be teasing a Captain America Civil War tie-in, similar to what they did previous season with Winter Soldier.
Oh, love it.
And also they did it with Age of Ultron.
Yes,
there's definitely going to be a major death in one of the final four episodes. Not sure who, but yeah, there's definitely somebody's definitely going to die.
I can't decide who I would be okay with. I think everybody has such a solid place in that team. They fill a particular void that if one of them goes, it's going to be super difficult to get that same family dynamic in the atmosphere.
Yeah, the thing that was really surprising with earlier in the season was that, they've written, they didn't kill off, but they've written, Bobby mm-hmm. and, oh my God, Hunter.
Mm-hmm.
Out of the show. I mean, technically, I mean, they can't work for S.H.I.E.L.D. anymore.
Right.
Because, they've been disavowed in their thing. So, I mean, that was kind of like, that was kind of heartbreaking to see. That was kind of emotional to see, especially with Jax and all that saying goodbye to him. That final goodbye, that spy's goodbye scene.
Oh, man.
I was like, oh, my God, you guys.
Yeah. When I saw Mac, like, tearing up, I had to look away.
Yeah, Max is just standing there. He's just like, "What is in your mind?" big old man, dude. Yeah. He's just the biggest. He is like the heart of the team, though,
yes,
man. That's
absolutely.
The thing that kills me about it. He's like the heart of the team. Big old softy. One of my favorite characters on that
definitely.
Show. So yeah, it's definitely going to have a, I guess the episode, there's a synopsis out for the episode Emancipation, which teases the tie-in for the Civil War. Mm-hmm. And they have I believe Marvel Television, it says here, Marvel Television, ABC, they have dubbed the final episodes of Marvel Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. as season three as Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Fallen Agent.
Oh, man.
Yeah, so how this Quinjet gets up in the orbit and then blows up, we do not know. Who's in it, we don't know yet. Who do you think?
Oh, man. I want to say Lincoln because he wasn't there from the beginning. And I feel like since we already lost two people that were so core, you know, major parts of the team, that they wouldn't take away somebody who was there from the beginning. You know, Sky/Daisy, you know, Fitzsimmons, obviously Coulson. I feel like the show would just fall apart if he left. Yeah. You know, and Mac, like you said, he's the heart of the thing. So I don't know. I don't know.
I noticed you didn't mention May.
I did not mention May. That might be a very interesting point.
I personally feel Lincoln, I think, is probably the best guess on there, but I feel it's probably going to end up being one of the other two Secret Warriors. The one girl, her nickname's Yo-Yo.
Right.
Or the other guy, I can't remember what his name is.
The one that he kind of controls metal.
Yeah, he can like melt metal and everything.
So do you think they would big up the prospect of losing an agent like so much if it was one of those guys?
Well, I mean, I think it's a possibility. Yeah, I mean, just to get people hooked.
Right.
You know, I mean, if it's one of them, it could possibly end up being a letdown.
Yeah.
On it, but at the same time, like you said, several of these characters are irreplaceable. You just can't take them off. I mean, you know, and you know, granted, I'd like to see where for some reason Ward's got Hive, somehow for some reason has a S.H.I.E.L.D. uniform on, and he's the one that freaking died. Ever since he turned, yeah. I have hated him so much. I'm like, you need to, like when Coulson crushed his chest in, I'm like, yeah.
Yeah, me too, a little bit.
And then when he showed up at the end of that episode, I'm like, no!
But it has given the actor a chance to stretch his legs a little bit.
Oh, yeah, yeah, that guy's been doing fantastic at that role. Fantastic at that role. He's so freaking menacing.
Yes.
So freaking menacing. We'll get into the whole episode here later. I think you got one more piece.
Yeah, we got Green Lantern here for the movie that's supposed to be out 2020, maybe, if I remember correctly. They're talking about, and this is a rumor here, from a Latino Review, which is, they've got a lot of good stuff, and sometimes they just fall flat on their faces. But there's supposed to be three humans in the Green Lantern movie. Three Green Lantern humans. And we all know the top three in everybody's mind. Hal Jordan, John Stewart, and Kyle Rayner.
Ah, right. But there's a fourth. There's a fourth.
The newest edition, comparatively or relatively?
Good old Guy.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, I thought you were going with the Islam dude. Oh, Guy. From DC Universe Online, I've just hated that guy. Hated him. Oh, my goodness. He's such a douche.
Well, I mean that's who he is. That's Guy.
Yeah. I mean. It is. Oh, it could be him. I guess. Yeah, they could do that.
Yeah.
There are a lot to choose from, but I would assume it would be those three because those are the three that have the biggest mind share with the fans.
Right. Right. But yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how they go with that and if the uniforms are CGI or not.
They would never hear the end of it, ever. Yeah. Famke Janssen, if you guys remember, she played Jean Grey from the first X-Men up through X-Men 3, where she died at the hands of Wolverine. And then she came back at the end of Days of Future Past.
Well, that's because it was entirely retconned.
Right. She would like to play an older version of Jean Grey alongside this new, younger version of Jean Grey that they have for X-Men Apocalypse, being played by Sophie Turner from Game of Thrones. She plays Sansa. Is it Sansa Stark?
Sansa Stark.
So she wants to get in on that action. I guess she's looking for work because I have not seen her in anything.
She's been on a TV series.
Is she? Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wasn't mad at her portrayal of Jean Grey. I think she was pretty good.
I thought she was really good. I don't think any of the actors should be blamed for Final Stand.
Yeah.
Or Last Stand or whatever. Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. I don't think any of the actors should be blamed for that. I believe that's purely on the directorial and screenplay. Man. Side of things there.
So much trash.
It wasn't that good. It was not that good. I think it'd be interesting to see, you know, her, like, looking forward at her future self.
Right.
One other thing that I completely forgot about. The rumored appearance of X-23 Wolverine 3 movie.
Yes. That should be very, very interesting.
Yeah.
A genetic clone of Logan there, but they obviously made her female.
Yes. Let me see if I can. And she's only got the two claws that come out of her hands.
Right.
But she's got another claw that comes out of her feet, apparently.
Which is pretty gross.
Yeah.
You know, she never got high in the popularity scales. Once the movie started coming out, because it was all about regular Wolverine, so
right,
you know. But then when they redid the whole Marvel thing and you know, all new Hulk and all new Wolverine, they had a female Wolverine. I believe it was X-23, but I am
well. Not yeah, sure. She has taken over the role of Wolverine,
right,
in the comics now. So because the actual Wolverine, the 616 universe Wolverine is dead.
Right,
but they have Old Man Logan is in there involved now. I don't know. My son used to explain all this to me, and he's still down in Texas. So
gotcha.
After he joined the Air, he's going through his technical schooling right now. after he joined the Air Force, so I haven't had to sit down and talk to him yet on, you know, getting caught up on the comics and stuff.
Okay, and last but not least, one of the final episodes of The Flash for the season will be directed by Kevin Smith.
Yes.
Right, the title of that episode is The Runaway Dinosaur. And in the news in the last couple of days, we've got, you know, quotes from Kevin Smith, quotes from Grant Gustin, Greg Berlanti, really, really talking up this episode, saying it's one of the best episodes that they've done. And Kevin Smith even said that it is his best director's gig. Like, this is the top directing he's done since he's been doing movies.
Yeah, well, I mean, he's talked about it on his a couple of his podcasts. Mm-hmm. I've listened to where, you know, he's talked about, you know, his time there. You know, obviously, you know, his, you know, put out anything specific about what the story is or anything like that. But, you know, he was talking about how, you know, he's had people come up to him, some of the producers and, you know, other people that work on the set, you know, tell him this. I mean, it's just really cool to have somebody here who knows this stuff and gets this. You know, because, I mean, they'll have, you know, because TV shows, you know, they rotate directors in and out all the time, you know, from the, you know, some of them at least. And, you know, sometimes you'll have a director that'll come in, may not really know the source material, you know, as deeply as somebody like Kevin Smith would.
Right.
You know, and not appreciate the fact that, you know, so, you know, they actually have a working Jitters, you know, coffee place there where they can get a Flash, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, that was one of the things he was talking about. You know, so they were like, you want to go to Jitters and get a coffee? Because they actually make coffee in that Jitters there. And he's like, yeah, man. He's like, can I get a Flash? And they were like, man, it is so cool that you know that, you know.
That is pretty cool. I'm excited to see that, and that can lead us right into our very first TV show for the week that we will discuss, The Flash.
Yes.
Right. So This episode was super duper good because we get to find out about Hunter Zolomon's childhood. Now, yeah. We were talking about this last week, you know, how come, you know, they think it's Jay straight away and what's her name? Caitlin hasn't brought up the fact that they found this doppelganger in Hunter Zolomon on the Earth and maybe it's him and all of this stuff. So we get a lot of the answers, a couple questions from this episode.
Yeah, the whole time echo thing with him going forward and, you know, getting his future self.
I believe it was his past self, wasn't it?
Yeah, something, one of those. I can't remember which. But, getting not his doppelganger, but actually himself to go along with all of this. Not just go along with all this, but go along with him killing him.
Right.
That's the level
of crazy we're talking about.
Yeah, that's what all kinds of do crazy right there. that's like diabolical. It's like, dude, you know what would really mess with them? If I kill you.
He's like, yeah.
Oh my God, that's brilliant. We should do that.
Unbelievable. I could not believe it when I heard it, that the guy, it took some convincing, but he actually was like, you know what? This is a fantastic plan. Let's let you kill me.
Yeah.
And he just did it. I was so surprised when he said that. I'm hoping there's more to the story. I did see an article saying that they're going to do a little bit more explaining about the Jay Garrick connection there, because a lot of fans were up in arms that they were making Jay Garrick a bad guy.
Yeah. That kind of rubbed me slightly the wrong way too, because I'm like, man, how are you going to do this to the Jay Garrick character?
Exactly.
You know, I mean, and I was kind of like, like that one, but you know what? Hey, you know, maybe Earth 4 Jay Garrick is really a good guy.
Yeah. We'll definitely find out. Hopefully. You know, but yeah, so as far as Hunter Zolomon, we find out that, I mean, his childhood was just garbage. His father was obviously an alcoholic and probably had PTSD from what it looked like. Mm-hmm. And he actually forced Hunter, his son, to watch him kill his mother.
Yep.
Unbelievable, right?
Yeah, he's so, raised and then he's, you know, sent off to an orphanage. Mm-hmm. You know, he's got no other family members. He's raised in this orphanage and he grows up to be a huge serial killer.
Yeah. Hannibal Lecter huge. I mean, like, dozens and dozens of kills. I forget what the number was.
I think it was like 21.
Something like that.
He was convicted of.
So God knows how much he actually
but
did,
this,
right?
All right, this is one of those things. This is one of those things that, like, really, it's one of those little story element things that always kind of annoys me just a little bit. You know, when, they're sitting there, they were there and they were talking about Jay's doppelganger. And they're like, how come Jay never, looked for his doppelganger here?
Right.
And she's like, oh, well, he found him and all that, but his name wasn't Jay Garrick, it was Hunter Zolomon. And then all of a sudden, ding, 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 ding. And I'm like, oh, God, if you guys, don't people talk anymore?
I mean, come on, that's huge. You find the guy is dying, and you find his doppelganger and find that he is dying too. And your whole arc in this thing, talking about Caitlin, has been trying to find a cure for this guy. And this never came up before in this room full of scientists? Come on, man.
Yeah, I know. It's one of those little things. I mean, I know it's a method, getting, you know, all these little things and all, and then all of a sudden things start coming together. I know it's a writing method, but it's one of those ones that annoys me just a little bit.
Not a fan.
But, so the whole story ends up going on where, he was getting electric shock treatments there, and he was going through getting electric shock treatments when the particle accelerator on Earth 2 exploded, and that is how he got the Speed Force and became Zoom, and then the whole thing with him being, Jay Garrick and being the Flash on there, he did just because it was really cool to be a superhero.
Yeah. Like,
that is so freaking evil, man. I was like, you know, he intentionally became a superhero to give people hope so he could take it away from them. You know who that reminds me of?
Who?
Zack Snyder. Yeah, I said it.
Cold-blooded.
Gave us hope with a Batman versus Superman movie, and then took it all away.
Oh, cold-blooded.
Yeah, that, I mean, that right there is evil in and of itself. It's like, I think sometimes I think the writers for this episode, they got together and they're thinking, what is some really evil stuff that somebody could do? And, you know, they put all these ideas in and they're like, okay, Zoom is going to do half of these.
Right.
All right, so let's go through and figure out which ones are the most evil. You know? and then they were like, okay, let's do it. Now let's throw it all into the episode. But, I mean, they didn't do it. I'm not saying that in a bad way.
Right.
I mean, this was like, you wanted to define somebody as an evil individual, man. This is the episode you watched, and you're, yeah, this guy's bad.
Yeah, this guy is bad news. Rotten to the core.
One thing I do hope that Barry learns in the future, though, is when he's beaten, you know, his arch nemesis,
mm-hmm,
and all that, he doesn't get as arrogant as he does.
Yes. I was so upset. Let me tell you.
I'm sitting there, and I'm like, you're talking too much, Barry. You're talking too much.
Barry, you're doing
what villains do when they've got you captured.
Right, because he's got this thing on his leg, his right leg.
Right.
And I'm like, okay, so this must be a speed dampener of some sort. Right?
Right.
But no, it is literally just a chain. It's a collar type. They think that his speed must be only in his right leg or something, because how do you not expect him not to do something with any other part of his body?
Yeah.
That made no sense to me.
Little things here and there, you know, annoyed me, and, you know, I didn't like about this episode. The episode as a whole was very good. The only other thing that I didn't like was the fact that Barry did not mention Supergirl once.
Yes.
Because this is supposedly the episode, you know,
when he comes back.
You know, he goes through the breach, he goes to meet Supergirl, and he comes back. And he didn't mention her once. He didn't come back and say, dude, guys, I met a girl in a red skirt and a red cape, and she can fly.
Yeah.
It was, you know, really cool.
He went to... he goes to a completely different Earth and meets the most powerful being he has ever come across.
Yeah.
Teams up with her, and she's the one that helps him get back, and mum's the word. He didn't say anything.
there was a lot of backlash about that. And I don't know if maybe that was just, copyright thing, you know, they couldn't mention, you know, her on the CW, but, you know, they could have him on CBS or what, I don't
Ryan.
Know.
Oh, man. I mean,
there may be copyright issues involved with that, but yeah, it was kind of disappointing that, you know, we didn't at least hear a blurb about it. Maybe we will in a future episode or something like that, but that was kind of upsetting. But overall, good episode. Do you really think he gave Zoom his speed?
I think he did, but the first thought I had, and this was before I even watched the episode, because it got spoiled for me, but the first thought I had when I heard that that speed was gone was that Wells did something that made it temporary, you know? So, like, you know what I mean? He put something in the device or whatever it was, and it would just, as Zoom used more and more of the speed, it would dissipate and slowly come back into Barry. And that's what I'm hoping is going to happen, unless they're going to try to recreate the accident like they did with in Flashpoint for the Flash to get his
power. Oh, yeah.
That was crazy
watching that. That was nuts. I think something along those lines too. I mean, they couldn't just give up his speed like that.
Yeah.
I think Wells did something where it is temporary, and Zoom got a loaded shot of Velocity 9.
That
is what
crazy.
I'm thinking.
Oh, man. Yeah. That would be bananas.
So, I don't know. We'll have to see how that goes. No Arrow this week, right, which I was actually kind of disappointed about.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I think it's coming back next week, right?
Yes, and then your episode next week.
We'll catch up on Arrow next week. Right. So let's lead into the Monday shows here, because we completely skipped that day.
Yes, we did.
Because you don't watch any of those shows.
I watch all of them, though. And I actually got to see the finale. I watched both.
Did you watch the finale for Supergirl?
I watched the finale for Supergirl.
Did you almost cry, too?
I did not almost
cry. Oh, my God, dude.
I did not almost cry. I tell you, the one scene blood that really running got through your veins was when she was talking to her sister when she was about to go up.
Ah.
Right? Now, initially in that scene, the sister didn't look like there was much emotion in her at all, acting-wise. And I was just like, man, this is just phoning it in or whatever. But then when she started to cry, I was like, oh, let me take some of my man pills here. A little, you know, it got to be.
I don't know. It may be because I'm getting older and I'm getting soft. And anything like that. But, I mean, certain things, you know, will get me to tear up. Mm-hmm. If there are emotional scenes...
Mm-hmm.
You know, I will get teared up over them. You know, perfect example is Force Awakens. Awakens, when I went and saw Force Awakens, I'm sitting there, and there's like two moments where there's actually more than two. But two specific moments that I can talk about that as far as, you know, emotional scenes are concerned, that can get me teared up is when Finn was fighting Kylo, having that lightsaber fight with Kylo, right? Mm-hmm. And Kylo knocks him down and all that, and knocked the lightsaber out of the air, out of the way. And, you know, and he puts his lightsaber away and he starts reaching for it. And, he starts reaching for it and it's not coming to him.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sitting there and I'm like, I'm sitting there, you know, my hands are folded in front of me, you know, like I'm praying, right, you know, watching this. And all I'm thinking to myself is, she's going to grab it. She's gonna pull it to her. You know, and then all of a sudden, shoom, man, went right into her hand. And I'm like, oh my God, JoJo, you bastard.
That was a nice scene.
I was like, oh my God, JoJo, you genius. That's so damn. Oh, I'm freaking crying over here. But, you know, I mean, the first 10 minutes of the show, I mean, I had me in tears.
Mm.
Had me in tears. She's sitting there having that speech, to, you know, talking about hope.
Right.
Hope, and I'm like, she needs to sit. Zack Snyder needs to be sat down and watch the first 10 minutes of this show. and I'm sitting there. I was like, oh my God. I'm like, you know, she's just talking about hope and hope and hope. And I'm like, oh my God, you stop it.
Right.
But yeah, the only issue I had with this episode. I mean, and I hate to sound like one of those people, he's got a problem with everything. Mm. You know, nothing's ever perfect enough for him, which isn't true. But the only issue I had with this episode was the fact that, you know, her speech worked, which that's not what I had the issue with. Her speech worked, National City saved, and then they're like, all right, back to business.
Yeah. Yeah, I felt the same way. When she came into the office and everybody was just chilling.
Yeah.
And she's like, oh, yeah. Everything worked out fine. Da, 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 da. Yeah, I had the same issue with that. Same issue.
Yeah, I was like, really?
Yeah.
they're still out there.
Yeah. That's exactly what I said. And then they kind of try to clean it up and say, oh, you know, the government organization, I forgot what the acronym is, they're looking for them or whatever. So when they find out, then, you know, we'll
go right.
It's like, okay, but it didn't feel like the world was about to end the night before.
You know it didn't feel like the day after the world almost ended. You know, where you're like, all right, everybody, you know what? Stay home, hug your kids, hug your wives, hug your husbands.
Yeah, it was a little weird.
Let's take a day off.
I'll tell you what, too. I actually did have a problem with the concept of the speech. Not like what the speech was or delivery. But I had a problem with, they were like, this is the plan, Supergirl and Kat. Mm-hmm. Now, they explained that there was science behind it, but my issue is, they didn't know that. when they brought the plan to him, they were like, we're going to do this instead of your surefire plan. His surefire plan, obviously, I don't agree with it. But when they came and said, this is the plan, we're going to appeal to them with hope, I was like, no.
There may have been some behind-the-scenes stuff right there. Because in my mind, you know, they're sitting there, it's like, we're not going to go with your plan, which involved detonating a nuke over the city right. and possibly killing hundreds of thousands of people.
Right.
Which we're not going to do that. So we're going to do something different. You know, if you are on board, you want to help and all that, then give us a better way. And for me, that, you know, involved him, you know, then going and looking and seeing exactly what kind of signal it was sending out, how was it affecting everybody's brains, and then him coming to that determination that, you know, it was affecting those two portions of the brain and all that, which, you know, affects, you know, a person's, you know, free will mm-hmm. and, you know, their ability to basically hope.
Mm-hmm.
So. Yeah,
but when they came to him, before he knew anything about it, they said that the plan was hope.
Hmm.
You know what I mean? And like I said, I got no problem with how it turned out as far as there being science behind it. But they were so, this is what's going to happen, before they knew the science. This is I'm talking about Supergirl and Cat. Before,
right.
This is when they first brought the plan to this guy. And to me, that just felt like their plan was, you know, it was just, their plan was hope. It was a hopeful thing, like, we're going to appeal to hope and hope that works out without any kind of, you know, foundation of an actual plan of what they're going to do. And I didn't like that, you know? Yeah. I mean, there's too much at stake for something like that. You know, what if the signal was going to a different part of the brain? Then what? What right. was your hopeful plan going to be?
You know, I mean, hope something else works.
But overall, I will say I actually enjoyed the episode. Oh, yes, I had a question, though. Maybe you can answer this, because this seemed to be something that happened from one of the episodes that I didn't see. But when the sister came, and she had that kryptonite kind of armor thing.
Right.
Is it just, like, protective armor, or was it something that increased strength?
I think it was an exosuit. It was an exoskeletal suit that had kryptonite in it. It was specifically made in order to fight Kryptonians.
Okay, so there has to be some kind of.
So there was like, yeah, it had enhanced strength to it, and you know, obviously it had the kryptonite on there to weaken her
right.
and everything. Because you know, I don't think they could make an exosuit that would be able to match a Kryptonian's
right.
strength. I mean, as we see, you know, later on in that episode, what's you know just how strong Supergirl is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, by, you know, taking Fort Ross and, you know, flying it up into space.
Right.
yeah, so,
pretty interesting.
so, yeah, I don't think it's something that could actually match, you know, Kryptonian strength, but, you know, with the kryptonite in it and everything, it was obviously meant to weaken her. This yeah. is something interesting that that suit right there is actually something very interesting, because that has me believing that we may
Metallo.
Yeah,
yeah. Boy.
Introduced in, that. You know, maybe possibly season 2,
mm-hmm.
Which would be very cool to see.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so, yeah, the whole episode was really good. I mean, you know, the scene where they were saying goodbye to each other, you know, I got, you know, like, I'm like, oh, man, you know, I was like, right. you know, and then when, you know, her sister, you know, comes up there flying in her pod and everything. You know, the scene after that when, you know, she's there laying recovering, you know, she's like, you're not the only badass in the family.
Right.
You
right.
know, and I was like, aw.
So this pod is still capable of flight.
Why wouldn't it be?
Right. But why haven't these people, like, taken it apart to, you know, increase their own technology?
Maybe they have. I mean, look at all the different. I mean, look at the containment cells they've got for all the prisoners of Fort Ross they've captured. You know, I mean, they've had to have reverse engineered some of that alien technology from that pod.
Yeah.
In order to figure it out, you know, in order to be able to do at least that, on top of you know being able to track them down, you know, and capture them and everything. So, yeah, the scene at the end, and all that. They're all getting ready to have dinner and all that. I thought right. that was really cool that, you know, I mean, the level of control she must have in order to pop that cork on that champagne bottle, but just by squeezing the bottle.
Yeah, and not breaking it.
Yeah. I was like, okay, that's legit. That is legit cool, you know. The whole conversation she has with Clark on IMs. I always mm-hmm. like it when they have those their little, you know, back and forth when they're talking. Even though they haven't had him on the show, right. technically. I always like the little back and forth, you know, when they're talking to each other and all that, you know, and he's, you know, message her, she's my hero and everything. And you know, that was really cute. This show, man, it just makes me feel good about watching a superhero, you know, TV show, man. I just love this show so much.
It's pretty happy. I would say that.
I mean, it's got its dark moments, you know, and it's, you know, moments, you know, where, you know, things aren't going the way they should be going, you know, and I mean, it doesn't make you feel like cutting your wrists at the end of every episode, you know. I mean, you know, like, so I mean, so you know, and that's one of the reasons why I love it so much. So quick question: mm-hmm. What do you think was in that pod? All right, let me tell you something. All right, she goes over, she opens that pod, she's like, oh my god. Credits. No!
Yeah. Yeah. I was pretty upset too.
I was like, you bastard!
I really wanted to know. And you know what? This doesn't make sense, but my first thought was that it was her. And this is probably because of the Flash and all the... And the fact... even in the beginning of the show, the fact that they were sent at roughly the same time from Krypton, but because of whatever happened in space during travel... She ended up there, same age she was when she left, but so many years after Clark landed.
So right, I think what happened was, I mean, because they both left at relatively the exact same time.
Right.
But I think they both traveled through the Phantom Zone okay. to get to our galaxy, and time, time is different in the Phantom Zone, inside the Phantom Zone.
So he probably entered first and exited first, which allowed more time to pass.
Right.
Or something like that. Right. That makes sense. But yeah, so because of that and the Flash and the universes and all of that, that was what the first thought was when she was like, oh my God. I'm thinking like she saw a much younger version of herself or something. Because I'm just wondering what else, like who else could have been in a Kryptonian pod?
Right.
It's gonna be interesting, though. I mean,
so you got no guesses?
No, just her. That's the only one I got.
Well, I can't really say for sure, I wouldn't really want to guess. But if I had to guess, I would say Crypto.
That is a very good guess.
That it's Crypto until I hear something different.
I don't know.
I highly doubt it's Crypto, but
it's definitely possible. But at the same time, if it did happen to be true, I don't know how much I would appreciate it to end on that kind of a cliffhanger.
To end on that kind of a cliffhanger and end up being a dog.
Yeah.
Yeah. Speaking of dogs, I'm gonna kill them. Yeah, I mean, for the end on that kind of cliffhanger and end up just being, you know, a dog, that would be a huge letdown.
Yeah.
For the, you know, to start off the second season. But, yeah, that's my joke answer, at least. It's Crypto.
It's Crypto. I mean, it would definitely make sense, you know, that the dog might have survived. You know how people are with their pets. Maybe they put him on a spaceship and send him out there, you know. But, yeah, it would definitely, like you said, it would be a letdown, I think, if they started the second season like that.
Yeah. I'm kind of curious to see how much more of the Martian Manhunter, not so much, you know, Hank Henshaw / you know, the Hank Henshaw character, but how much more of the Martian Manhunter we're actually going to see in season 2. Because that's got to be some work with the CGI for him and the makeup and all that. That's got to be some work getting him into that suit. So we'll have to see how much more of the Martian Manhunter. I mean, it'd be cool to see more of him.
Yeah, it would.
Don't get me wrong.
It's a cool character, man.
Yeah, definitely a cool character. So also Monday we had Gotham.
Yes, we
did. Have you completely caught up with Gotham now?
Completely caught up.
Completely caught up. Mm-hmm. So what do you think? Barbara is back. There's a lot of people who don't like her.
Yeah, I mean,
the majority of people I talk to that have major issues with Gotham hate that character.
I loved her initially. Yeah. When I actually liked the show in the beginning, I loved her because she was super understanding of the job of Jim and his need to be in the job and all of that. And then, like,
they broke her.
Yeah.
They broke her.
They just turned her into this damsel in distress and brought that the woman that she was a lover with from before. And then from that point on, she just descended into this pit of nonsense.
Yeah. But I'll tell you what, though. That woman, that actress, she can play crazy real well.
She plays
crazy real well.
She is pretty dope.
So this episode here, we had, obviously, you know, we had Jim Gordon and Bruce Wayne finally getting together, and to work on who killed the Waynes, where Jim finding out who it was that hired the assassin, the hitman, matches Malone, who Bruce found out was the one who actually pulled the trigger, who ended up killing himself in a previous episode.
Right.
They find out who contracted him, which was the lady who she is a person who sends out hitters
right
on people, and she had actually in another previous episode had sent out four assassins to kill Jim Gordon, and they failed, and she had gone into hiding. So this episode had him hunting her down, trying to find her so he could find out who contacted her to contract out Matches Malone to kill the Waynes. And actually, ironically, with Barbara Keene's help, even though he didn't know he was getting help from her at the time, he finds out that the name that the person who put out the hit on the Waynes was going by the name The Philosopher. So that led me to thinking, okay, what Batman villain went by the name of The Philosopher once? Mm-hmm. And I'm racking my brain during this whole time. Meanwhile, Bruce is helping out a young woman who his father knew, who was actually a victim of one of the experiments that Wayne Tech was involved in that had gotten out of his control. Because they've actually been able to hack into, or they've repaired the computer hard drive and all that stuff that Thomas Wayne was using, that Bruce found in his beginner bat cave.
Right.
let's face it, it's the beginner bat cave. It's got a computer. It's got a bat computer in there, but it's still it's a HP.
Yeah. got Windows 95, but it's still
Cortana hasn't been installed yet, so they're having trouble unlocking some of the files.
Yeah.
So they're, he goes through, he found this girl and all that. They end up tracking her down to, and his father had met with her the day before, he died, before he was killed. Mm-hmm. And they find out this girl had actually been part of an experiment where they completely replaced her hand with, I don't know, what was that? That looked like a turkey.
It did. My first thought was like reptilian, but now that you say that, it really does.
It looked like a turkey foot. And I'm like, with turkey's feet, they kind of look, they do have large talons, not to sound like Napoleon Dynamite there, but do the chickens have large talons?
I never complained.
Boy, I don't know what you're saying. But yeah, it looked like a huge turkey foot.
Yeah.
She
certainly knew how to use it, I'll tell you that.
Yeah, she did. She slit that dude's throat.
Right? Oh my
gosh. Deep, too, man. It was like 2 or 3 inches deep.
Oh this is for last Thanksgiving. And then she just went.
My people will be free.
Yeah.
Pardon this, Mr. President.
Right.
It was dope.
Oh, man. But, we got to see Mr. Freeze this episode. The first incarnation of Mr. Freeze with his Freeze suit.
Right.
And all that. And the whole goal of Mr. Freeze, you know, coming out was just to kill this girl. Which kind of disappointing to me. Yeah. I was like, oh, man.
Freeze and everyone now.
And then we see Bruce taking more of a darker turn. You know, that more, you know, character development and evolution of Bruce Wayne towards becoming Batman, where, you know, he, you know, doesn't hold himself responsible for it, but, you know, he's holding the people behind it all responsible.
Right. That speech that Alfred gave him, because at first he was holding himself responsible, and then Alfred said, like, I mean, if that's how you're going to do this, then you're not ready.
Yeah.
Because there's going to be more. Like, people are going to die if you're going to continue on this.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was good. I like that. I really did like that.
Yeah. Yeah. Alfred is doing very well as a very reluctant mentor.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you can tell he's very reluctant about a lot of this stuff. But he knows that Bruce is going. He's going to go out and do it anyways. You know what I mean? He's like, I'm going to go meet this girl. He's like, you're either coming or you're not.
Yeah.
And Alfred's basically. Like. Figured that.
But you're going to eat something.
He's like, you at least eat something on the way. We stop and get some Taco Bell at least.
That was
pretty. They're serving breakfast now.
He's one of my favorite characters in that show, honestly. Alfred, they really picked a good guy.
Yeah. Alfred, I mean, the exasperation on him is what I really like about it, because he's just like, this freaking kid. Yeah. But, was pretty good there. Barbara ending up back in
Butch's house.
Butch's house. I was like, why did she go there? And how did she know that woman was there?
That's a good question.
You know, I mean, that was kind of iffy for me and all that. I'm wondering if, you know, Barbara's, you know, actually, you know, slipping back into her old ways or not, and is not rehabilitated, which was obviously, you know, implied when she was released from Arkham.
Right.
So we'll have to see where that goes, if we're going to see some more of the crazy king girl.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see where that goes. As far as the philosopher, the identity of the philosopher was revealed.
Right.
And it turns out to be Hugo Strange.
Of course, because who else?
Which, of course, it makes sense. You know, Hugo Strange has been, he's been running these special little projects on the side while he is the, you know, in charge of Arkham Asylum. You know, if Thomas Wayne was getting too close to something, it would make sense that Hugo Strange would put the hit out.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does. We do find out that he's the guy, and basically he's just been doing what he's always been doing. So what we see him doing here in Arkham with these patients is basically, you know, his MO. So it makes sense that it's him. It makes sense that he's the one that put the hit out, unless they try to do some other, you know, misdirect or whatever, to say, oh, but someone told me that I needed to put the hit out on him or something. I
mean, yeah.
You know.
So, all right. So then we have Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Oh, well, we didn't talk about one thing. Oh,
what's that?
The philosopher, a.k.a. Dr. Strange, finally got his reanimation project to work.
Oh, God. Oh, my God. I can't believe the huge thing that
at
the end. And I completely freaking forgot about it.
Yep.
Yes, yep. We saw the resurrection or the rising of Azrael. Yes,
we did.
Azrael.
Who else but Galavant?
Oh, yeah. Yep, they resurrected Galavant, brought Galavant back to life, sort of.
Right, sort of. We don't know the extent yet.
Which and we've actually seen, I don't know if you've seen them or not, there have actually been some behind-the-scenes pictures of that actor walking around in the Azrael costume.
I saw one little bit more than headshot image of it, but nothing more than that. I've seen.
Yeah, I saw the one I saw was like, you know, in between shots or something like that, right. And he had it was a full. I mean, it was kind of from a distance, but it was like a full body shot of him wearing the whole outfit. I mean, it looks kind of like the outfit from the Arkham games.
Oh, okay, got you. Right. Okay.
So I was like, ooh, damn, they did really good with that.
Yeah. Yeah, I can't wait for that. I mean, we all know from back in when Galvin first joined, we found out he was Order of Saint Dumas.
Yes.
That had ties to the Nightfall comic series. That's the one where Bane broke Batman's back, and then a vigilante named Azrael had to take over. Which didn't end well, but it's really fun to see the connections there.
Much more brutal Batman.
Right. Much more brutal Batman. Just even worse than Batman v Superman's Batman. He was just
more brutal than the BVS Batman.
Yeah.
Talking about the next two shows here, which starting with second to last, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Yeah.
We talked about the news and all that earlier and all that with Hive and how diabolical he is. Mm-hmm. He's actually able to infest the minds of Inhumans and control them.
Which is a little disgusting if you've ever seen it happen. He basically, whatever eczema he has, he just shoves it into your eye sockets and nostrils and mouth and everything, and then you become his slave.
Yes. Basically.
You know? So they started out with a mission. Secret Warriors were in action trying to save Coulson.
Which was really cool. Which was really cool. Really cool seeing the Secret Warriors working together and everything like that. Going in there to save Coulson and the rest of the team. Mm-hmm. Poor May got beat up.
Yes, she did. She won that fight, but she really she took some hits there. And I saw on Twitter somebody put up a picture where it was basically Street Fighter versus Mortal Kombat, because if you remember, she played Chun-Li in the Street Fighter movie with Van Damme, and he played Kung Lao in Mortal Kombat, I think, 2? Yeah, I think Mortal Kombat 2, the movie. So it was pretty fun to see that reunion. Or not reunion, but that battle there of the franchises. Pretty interesting. You know. But yeah, so she got a little beat up, and but they were able to overcome that. The Secret Warriors saved them and got a consolation prize in Malik.
Yes. Captured Malik. Were able to get Malik out of there and all that and start talking to him. And Malik was definitely, he was ready to, you know, jump ship.
Yes, he was.
You know, Hive actually, you know, having killed his daughter, to prove a point to Malik, but you know, the whole the revelation though that, you know, that he's able to, you know, infest and control Inhumans really put everybody on edge, and which ended up putting the Inhuman members of the Secret Warriors on edge, it's kind of divided the team now. Not just because, you know, of what happens at the end, and we find out who actually was under control, which very 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 cleverly use of deception there by making it look like it was Lincoln, because Lincoln, it made sense.
Yeah,
it made sense that it was Lincoln. But it turns out it's Daisy, you know, Quake, Tremors, as Mac likes to call her. She's known as Quake in the comic book, though. But yeah, it turned out it was Daisy, and I can't remember exactly what happened at the end when she went out in the hangar.
She just started to wreck shit. I mean, she just started to use her powers to make, like, as if an earthquake was happening, and then we saw the ceiling come down on Coulson, basically. So we don't even know what the state of his health is when the next episode pops up here. You know, yeah, she stole the orb, and she stole a bunch of the crystals that allow for the pterogenesis transformation in humans. And she's on her way. She's on her way to her man there, Hive. And this, the first thing I thought when I saw this was Grant Ward's memories are influencing Hive to make these kinds of decisions, because we know how Grant Ward feels about Daisy.
Right.
You know, so that was pretty interesting. I like that they were doing And they set the stage for that in when they were showing how much Malik's brother was influencing Hive when they were discussing.
That was just like, that was the emotional teardown on Malik. Mm-hmm.
Yes, it was.
It's like, we had a deal, brother. You're like, oh man, you asshole! You went there. Yeah. You went there. So yeah, it's gonna be definitely interesting. You know, obviously the news. You know, somebody's definitely gonna die.
Right.
We don't know who yet, and there's gonna be, you know, ties in with Civil War opening May 6th.
Oh my gosh.
Well, either May 3rd will be. You know, it'll have. I mean, there's like no synopsis for it at all. So there may be some like lead ups to Civil War on that episode. The May 10th episode definitely has, you know, aftermath stuff. And then there's two more episodes after that. Well, actually, I'm sorry, not two more episodes, but a 2-hour finale on the 17th. So, all right. And that leads us up finally into Legends of Tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
Come with me if you want to live.
Yeah.
Loved that. Loved it. Loved it.
The guy's so quirky.
Yeah. I mean, he can be such a cornball sometimes. Yeah. But, I mean, that's why you like Ray.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's why you like Ray, because he's a cornball. Very interesting story. Timeline stuff, really, yo, I mean, God, they are doing so much with it.
Oh my God. There is no wonder.
This episode alone. With all the stuff they did to mess with the timeline, it's no wonder they're being hunted.
Yeah. It's true, man. You get to see what the Time Masters are going through just watching the events unfold.
Yeah, and I'm sure they're probably sitting there like, he did what? Oh, my God!
Again? This guy's just, he's out of control with this stuff.
Yeah.
And his younger self commit murder. Or at least, you know...
Yeah.
I mean, come on.
I thought the thing is he didn't tell the kid or give the kid the knife to do that.
Oh, that's right.
He knew how that kid would react. He knew how his younger self would react to somebody trying to hurt him. And that kid's like stabbed that woman in the leg, and he's like, "You think you're gonna do something to me, miss?" Stabbed her again.
Laughing about it too. This kid is unbelievable.
I was like, what a little shit.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, man.
Definitely, it was a good episode. I thought it was a good episode. It's definitely put them on a definitive path, though.
Yeah.
Now, you know, this is like what we were talking about. We were talking about last podcast. Mm-hmm. You know, what do they do once they beat Vandal Savage? Eventually, they're going to have to beat Vandal Savage.
That's it.
And it looks like now they're coming up to that point where, you know, it's coming to that point where they have to beat Vandal Savage. Because if they do not, then all of them are going to be erased from the timeline. Because, you know, they've secreted away all the babies of all the ones and all that. And I'm sorry, that Hot Girl and... Sarah's reaction to seeing Snart as a baby.
Oh my gosh.
I was like, that makes sense. That makes sense. You know, there's, and of course he's the only one there wrapped up in a blue blanket.
Yeah.
With a little blue beanie on and everything. And I was like, oh, this is perfect. And then you just the cutest little psychopath baby in the world.
Forget that this is like super powerful being coming after you, you know.
Yeah.
We gotta take time to admire this child and all that crap. I mean, oh my gosh, man. And that's another thing. I mean, I kind of didn't like that the assassin had all these crazy abilities.
Like, yeah, the whole time slowing thing down. That was like, ooh.
Yeah, and I mean, and is she just bulletproof? Because they were shooting at her in one of the...
Oh my God, yeah, they were those Starling City PD guys, man.
Yeah.
Cops, man, they were unloading on her, and you could see the bullets just ping, 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 ping. But I'm thinking to myself, I was like, you know, that's not like fully full body.
Exactly.
You know, she's got an exposed neck and head. You know, I mean, you know, I know, you know, you're taught to shoot center mass, but I mean, you see your first half of your mag bounce off the woman's coat. You know, maybe aim for the head.
Yes, exactly.
Especially when she's 4 feet away from you.
Right. You know, I mean, I was like, wow, what is happening here? You know, I wish they gave her more of a skill-based set instead of this, you know, powerful
toss the people around and slowing down time.
Yeah, I mean, it just, I don't know, it just felt like, well, I mean, I guess we got a guy flying around on fire, so it makes sense. Or you know, but yeah, overall, I think the episode was pretty good, and if nothing else, like you were saying before, it does put them on a definitive path, and I think it's about time, because I'm kind of tired of it just being every episode is how can we mess up the timeline?
What can we do? What can we do to change time today?
Yeah.
The scene though where Jax gets to meet his father, I thought that was really well. Now, all right, this is not me having any issue with the show at all.
Okay.
All right, this is me just, you know, being the former military man that I am. All right, having an issue with shows not paying attention to the way uniforms are in with the military.
Okay.
Because I'm watching every scene with Jax when he's talking to his father, every scene with his father in it, and I could not help but stare at that those upside down chevrons on his collars. You know, the man's in the army.
Right.
His chevron was upside down. That's not how the army wears their ranks. Yeah, being an army brat, I know this.
Right.
And I'm sitting there looking at that's it distracted me the entire time during that scene. You know, it was a constant distraction for me. So, you know, cuz I'm looking at them, talking, you know, to each other and all that, and you know, my eyes, like, you know, I'm doing one of those, you know how when you're looking at somebody but you see something going on behind that person?
Yeah.
You know, and you're looking at them, you're listening, you're not, and you're like, but your eyes keep constantly going to whatever it is, you know, the juggling kangaroo, right, you know, behind them. And you're like, what is that? Oh my God.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
It was juggling kangaroo. Yeah, it was constantly, you know, distraction. So, I mean, just one thing I implore any TV series out there, and all, if you're going to have people in, you know, in your show, with, you know, where they're wearing military uniforms, the military rays are easy to look up. They're on the internet. Mm-hmm. They'll tell you exactly how those things are. You know, costumers, right. Do your jobs.
Yeah, yeah.
All
right. I didn't notice because I don't know, you know, what would be right and wrong as far as those little details or what have you.
Right.
But even if I did, I probably wouldn't have noticed, and that's because I was so sure that Jax was going to try to save him, convince him not to be at some place or whatever. And those things, like we talked about before, bother me so much. Because at the end there, what's his name? Rip goes, you know, maybe time wants you to be together with your father. And I'm like, yo, you guys have lost all sense of responsibility.
I know, right?
All
Let's go kill Hitler.
Yeah, I mean, why not, right? At this point. It's ridiculous. I'm thinking to myself, Jax got his powers because he was on a football field playing football. And even by his own admission, everything that he did, he's wondering in the back of his mind, you know, would his dad be proud of him or how would he feel about this? And that pushes somebody. So what if his dad was around and maybe he didn't care about football? Maybe he wanted to follow his dad's footsteps and join the army.
Yeah.
So he wasn't really into the football thing at the time. So he wasn't where he was supposed to be, and he doesn't become Firestorm. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like they don't care about anything.
Yeah.
They don't care one bit.
Yeah. It's like the only person who is actually interested in maintaining the timelines,
mm-hmm.
you know, is Professor Stein.
Yeah.
He's the only one that's really interested, you know, in, like, you know, no, we can't do this because of that.
Right.
You know?
Right.
But
even him, when it gets emotional, he like, he saves H.G. Wells in the last episode. He didn't know who that was until after he had already met.
So I had to take that back about Stein then. Because, yeah, he got emotional and saved that kid, who turned out to be H.G. Wells. So, you know, which lends some theory towards, you know, Rip saying, you know, sometimes time, you know, will make things happen because it wants it to be that way.
Right.
You know, so, I don't know.
My thing is, because you don't know, you have to follow your heart, right?
Yeah.
And my thing is, we're talking about an entire planet. Your heart, your decisions that you make are based on your experiences, things that surround you in your bubble of life. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe somebody in England or somebody in Saudi Arabia grew completely differently with a completely different set of ethics, and they would have done things completely differently in the timeline too. But that person would be wrong if it ended up bad. You know what I mean? What if that person did something different and, you know, H.G. Wells died? But that person was following their heart.
Yeah.
But you know that the show, that they would have blamed this person for whatever mess was going on. I mean, it's got to be good for the goose and the gander, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Ugh, but whatever. Maybe the show is... It is less than what I want it to be. So the show
needs to be more like Quantum Leap was when it comes to the changes they make to the timeline.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely.
It needs to be more like, you know, so, you know, this, okay, this, all this bad stuff happened, all that you need in order for, you know, you to go forward in time. For everybody out there that doesn't know what Quantum Leap was, show that aired in the late 80s, early 90s. Mm-hmm. All right. It was about a guy who traveled through time, but he would take over the bodies of other people within his own lifetime.
Right.
So from like the day he was born, which I think it was like August something, 1953. Don't ask me why I remember this. But up until I think, gosh, when was that show taking place? In 1999, I think. Which. Yeah, okay. But he would travel back in time. He was, you know, in a particle, it wasn't a particle accelerator or anything like that, but, you know, he traveled back in time and he would take over, he would go into the bodies of people and he would have to right some of the wrongs that were happening in their lives in order for him to leap,
right.
Quantum leap into another time period to where, you know, and he had to continuously do this, you know, in the hopes that one time, you know, one of those leaps would actually bring him back home.
Right.
So a lot of it was, you know, had a lot to do with him, you know, saving somebody's life or, you know, standing up to somebody or, you know, righting a wrong or, you know, solving a murder or something like that. One time he even leapt into the body of Lee Harvey Oswald a few times. Very interesting. Couple episodes with that was very, very interesting to watch. It was around the 30th anniversary of his assassination too, by the way, and I remember that because I was in basic training and I missed it. but they need to be more like Quantum Leap with, I mean, because, like, you know, Stein saving that kid's life and finding out it was H.G. Wells, that was a Quantum Leap ending to the show.
Yeah,
that was a Quantum Leap type ending to the show. Yeah, if they're going to be going around, man, changing the timelines and stuff like that, man, they need to be a little bit more Quantum Leap-ish.
Yeah. It's like they're all millennials that don't care about what's happening around them. It's just like, oh, this is right in front of me, that this one thing that I care about, and I'm going to change this to what I want it to be. Without any regard to how it affects anything else. And, I mean, that's just... It's just the most selfish thing being paraded as heroism.
Yeah. The one character that I've noticed that he's... and this is going to take you by surprise. He, you know, he may not give a shit about anybody there and all that, but he's never done anything to mess up the timeline at all. And that's Heatwave.
Yeah, absolutely.
The one time he was going outside of the mission, you know, for the team. He wanted to stay in the future.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. You know, right.
which wouldn't technically have been a problem. Like, I don't see how that would have affected the events leading up to what you call it.
Well, I mean, it may not have. It may not have affected it at all. You know, him being, you know, captured by the Time Masters and turned into Kronos, which I thought was a very interesting turn on him. It's actually changed his character too. I don't know if you've noticed that or not.
Oh yeah.
He's definitely acting differently than he was before. You know, he's not as hot-headed and, you know, quick on the trigger.
Right. He's more intelligent and he's, so he's more intelligent. Like you said, he's not as hot-headed or whatever. You definitely notice the changes, and I would have been pretty upset if there were no changes.
Because yeah.
He said that he was there for, like, what, decades or something like that?
Yeah.
Man. And it's just, wow.
Yeah. But, hopefully they start wrapping this Vandal thing up because... they need to now.
Yes.
They definitely need to now. That's going to leave you wondering, you know, what are they going to do with season two? If there is a season two. I mean, because the show's doing well.
Right.
The show is doing well. But, you know, once they, you know, take out the main antagonist, you know, this is the same, this is the problem I brought up, you know, that before. I mean, what do they do in season two? They, you know, spend all season two running away from the Time Masters the whole time? Yeah. Or do they have to go back and, you know, fix all the stuff they broke?
I mean, and there's always another. You pull out one weed, and there's one ready to take its place. So you know, maybe removing Vandal from power enables something else to happen that messes stuff up that they have to go take care of, or something like that. You know, I mean.
Well, see, the thing is, for them, and even for Rip, you know, this all takes place. I mean, this takes place in the future.
Right.
You know, for Rip, it takes place in his present, I believe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, or recent past, I believe. So, you know, I mean, no wait, he's from further ahead than that.
Who, Rip?
Yeah. He's from, like, the way ahead.
You sure?
Yeah. Well, you know who his dad is, right? Which makes me wonder if we're going to see him.
I hope not.
Oh, come on, dude.
No, I like him. I don't want it to be soon, because that's a huge character
to
bring in on an offshoot. You know what I mean?
Yeah. That would be cool, though. That's going to be cool if they ever bring him in.
Now, I forgot what they said. Did his mom die when he ended up at the orphanage?
They didn't specify.
Okay.
They didn't specify. All right. But, yeah, so Legends of Tomorrow, definitely check it out. It's a good show. It's coming up on its season finale as well here, I believe, in a few episodes. And maybe we will actually see the death of Vandal Savage sometime in the future. Literally.
We're seeing stuff on Twitter now about what's his name coming back, Carter.
Really?
Maybe in the next episode or the one after that, I don't know. Because what's, I don't remember her real name, but Hawk Girl gets her mace, I think, in the next episode.
Oh, about time.
Right.
About time.
So that should be interesting. It's interesting. If you can get past all the little details that kind of annoy you, it's an interesting show.
Yeah.
I would recommend checking it if you are a comic book fan. If not, then I wouldn't waste my time. But yeah, man. Gotham, Supergirl, Flash, Arrow, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., and Legends of Tomorrow. Those are the shows we'll be discussing most. And then obviously when Netflix does their shows, Daredevil, Jessica Jones, Iron Fist, Luke Cage, we'll talk about those as well. And we'll be bringing you more news at the head of the show every week from now on. Right?
Yep.
So. So, yep, so that's basically it. We have covered everything we wanted to cover, I think. Next week we will be talking about the same things, and we will have some more, hopefully some more insight as to what may be going on in Civil War from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., which I'm pretty excited about, so stay tuned for that. I want to thank Super Patriot of the Daddy's House for sticking with us here at the Superpower Review. I am Neo Synapse once again, and we will see you guys next time inside the review.